Humans have been mining lead for a pretty long time, almost 6,000 years by most estimates. Lead is malleable, has a low melting point, is highly resistant to corrosion, all things that make it very versatile. It's basically the perfect metal, except of course it isn't, because lead is highly toxic. While lead's toxicity is something we seem to have only discovered in the 1970s and 80s, eventually resulting in the banning of lead-containing fuels by the late 1990s, lead poisoning was absolutely not a foreign concept to ancient peoples. The earliest written account of lead toxicity appears in an ancient Egyptian medical manuscript, where lead-containing compounds appear to have been commonly used for homicidal purposes. The ancient Romans went on to produce roughly 60,000 tons of lead each year, and eventually the connection between lead and its toxic effects on people became impossible to ignore. Dioscorides described the manifestations of lead exposure, stillbirths, deformities, and cases of brain damage. Almost 2,000 years ago, we're basically known to some degree about lead's toxic effects on both mind and body for over 2,000 years. And yet a study published just last year by UNICEF tells us that 1 in 3 children around the world have unacceptably high blood lead levels. Children are the group most sensitive to lead's toxic effects, courtesy of their developing brains. And the effects that lead can have on children are nothing short of significant. As multiple studies reveal that exposure to lead can result in reduced IQ, hyperactivity, and difficulties in processing emotions. To put this into perspective, 1 in 3 children worldwide, or roughly 800 million children, have unacceptably high levels of lead, around 5 micrograms per deciliter, or more. These 800 million children are at a 25% increased risk of academic failure, purely due to their blood lead levels, according to a 2015 study of children in Chicago's public schools. The problem is so profound that several historians have even argued that widespread lead poisoning amongst ancient Rome's middle and upper classes, who were often exposed to lead through tainted wines and through plumbing networks that were made out of lead, contributed to the eventual decline and fall of the ancient Roman Empire. In short, lead drove the Romans insane. But according to the CDC and most international guidelines, you don't need to worry about having a fate similar to that of the ancient Romans, so long as your blood lead levels are no higher than 5 micrograms per deciliter. But here's why I think the CDC and most international guidelines are wrong, and why there is no, absolutely no, safe levels of lead exposure. My name is Hashim and I'm a University of Cambridge graduate and student doctor, and this is my YouTube channel where I get to read all about science and medicine and share all the cool stuff that I learn with you guys. If you happen to like science and you want to see more science on your YouTube homepage, then you should absolutely subscribe. To check out the links, all the references that I used in the making of this video, you should head over to Substack, link in description below. And now back to lead. I mentioned earlier that children with blood lead levels higher than 5 micrograms per deciliter were at a 25% increased risk of academic failure. That number, 5 micrograms per deciliter, is widely considered to be the cutoff mark for safe blood lead levels, and so you'll see it used in a lot of conversations about lead toxicity. That number, however, isn't based on any substantial amount of science. In the United States, the CDC only uses 5 micrograms per deciliter as a reference value because that number represents the blood lead levels of the highest 2.5% of US children tested. In reality, 5 micrograms per deciliter is still far, far too high, and toxic manifestations can occur at levels much lower than that value. As illustrated by this wonderful 2010 study, in this study, children with blood lead levels above 2.18 micrograms per deciliter were almost 3 times more likely to receive an ADHD diagnosis as children with lead levels below 2.18 micrograms per deciliter. And for those concerned about their children's intellectual function and intelligence, here's some bad news for you. According to another study, at levels below 10 micrograms per deciliter, each 1 microgram increase in blood lead levels corresponds to a 1.37-point decline in overall IQ. Needleman was able to show as early as 1990 that children who did not show any of the toxic physical manifestations associated with lead toxicity but still had elevated blood lead levels had an IQ that was on average 6 points below their peers who had undetectable levels of lead in their blood. What makes all of this even more troubling is the fact that there are several more studies which suggest that a 1 microgram increase in blood lead levels is likely to have a more profound impact below the 5 microgram per deciliter mark than above it. This means that an increase in blood lead levels from 2 micrograms to 3 micrograms is likely to have a more significant or more damaging effect than an increase from 8 to 9. It might be the same increase in absolute terms, but it's likely to be far more damaging and significant on the lower end of the spectrum. This is probably why several scientists think that the CDC should revise its guidelines down from 5 micrograms per deciliter down to at least 3 micrograms per deciliter, but some scientists think that we should go even further. The truth is lead's toxicity on both the brain and kidneys is observed at levels as low as 2 micrograms per deciliter, and there seems to be absolutely no safe threshold for lead exposure.
All lead is bad.
Unlike other metals, lead serves no function in the human body, and so according to some scientists, we should be working to achieve undetectable levels of lead, corresponding to being anything below the 0.7 micrograms per deciliter mark. But here's some more bad news for you. A study published this year showed that toxic tetraethyl lead from petrol, which was banned 20 years ago, can still be found in London's air. And while levels of lead are much, much lower than their peak in the late 1980s, around 2% of what they used to be, this doesn't mean that the lead problem just went away. That's because lead just doesn't go away. Lead doesn't degrade, and once it's in the environment, it will be there to stay. Which means that the air in London may have a lot less lead in it, but that's only because the lead just went somewhere else, in the soil, mainly. In fact, many urban areas all over the world have elevated soil lead concentrations, a result of the large-scale use of lead in paints and in car fuel several decades ago. And because soil just happens to be where we grow our food, diet has now become the primary source of lead exposure, according to several studies from China, Russia, and Brazil. In other words, we royally screwed up. It obviously did not have to be this way. Tetraethyl lead, used in leaded gasoline, at its peak was responsible for a grand total of 98% of all lead pollution. First introduced in the 1920s as a means of improving engine performance, it wasn't long before scientists saw the emerging public health crisis. It took 60 long years, however, before leaded gasoline was abandoned, primarily because industry just would not cave in. General Motors went as far as hiring this guy, Robert Cahoo, in 1924 as director of the Kettering Institute, whose role became to deny all research into the dangers of lead and the existence of subclinical toxicity. Industry felt very strongly about leaded fuel, so much so that Frank Howard, spokesperson of the Ethyl Gasoline Corporation, called the continued development of motor fuels to be essential to civilization, and that the discovery of tetraethyl lead was an apparent gift of God. And how can you possibly turn down a gift from God? A gift which happens to mimic and replace calcium, magnesium, and zinc inside your body. How can you possibly do that? You mad? I guess you might be if your blood lead levels are high enough. What makes lead atoms so toxic is that they carry a double positive charge, similar to calcium, and are also roughly the same size as calcium atoms. This allows lead atoms to get inside your cells in place of calcium, where they can have some very disastrous consequences. Lead is known, for example, to inhibit the enzyme nitric oxide synthase, whose activity is essential in the hippocampus for both learning and memory. Lead can also stimulate cells to release vast quantities of glutamate, an excitatory neurotransmitter, which over time can result in neuronal apoptosis, a process where the cells begin to die. Lead also increases the production of reactive oxygen species in mitochondria, in brain cells, mitochondria being the energy-producing organelles in the cell, and a depletion in mitochondriae compromises neuronal function. All this happens in an environment of increased brain inflammation, inflammation being key because it's that inflammation which weakens the blood-brain barrier, making the brain more susceptible to toxins that are traveling inside your bloodstream. Astroglia, meanwhile, are a type of support cell in the brain which provide neurons with nutrients, chemicals, and clear up brain debris. These cells are able to absorb large quantities of lead, initially, providing some degree of neuroprotection, initially. With prolonged exposure, however, astroglia, they just give up and start releasing the neurotoxic lead back into the brain. Even they can't handle it. And just like lead doesn't go away from the environment once it's there, lead doesn't go away once it's inside your body. Lead will replace calcium in bones, which begins storing lead like it's going out of fashion. Eventually, in middle and in old age, with osteoporosis, this lead is released back into the blood, a process which is believed to be responsible, at least in part, for the cognitive decline that is observed in older adults. Like Alzheimer's. In other words, don't count yourself safe, even as an adult, from lead's toxic effects. There is absolutely no denying that the situation today is so much better than it used to be in the 1980s and 1990s. This is obviously due to the fact that we as a society decided to come together and ban the use of tetraethyl lead in gasoline. This was probably the best thing that we could do, even if it was a few decades too late. However, the lead that we released back in that era still makes itself seen through the consequences it has on our health today. Something I didn't cover in this video is that many older cities still have water supply pipes that are made out of lead. They are capable of having disastrous consequences like those that were seen in Flint, Michigan several years back. Another thing I wish I had more time to cover is the substantial amount of research suggesting that lead toxicity contributed to the increase in crime that was observed in the 1970s, and that the subsequent drop in crime rates in the following decades were a direct result of lead being banned in gasoline fuel, rather than increased policing. Tell me in the comments if you'd like to watch a video about that, or anything else for that matter. I'm at your service. See you all next week, and until then, you can keep yourself busy watching my video. It's an oldie but a goodie, a goldie, about how the sugar that you consumed as a child affects your memory today. See you all next week, and love you all to bits.